Doris with all of the books. Now Shawn the Book Maniac and I are here with our second installment of our Faber Story series. This is an Elegy for Easterly by Petina Gappah. Now I had never heard of Petina Gappah prior to getting this little gem. So I did a little research on her, and she's pretty awesome. So she was born and raised in Zimbabwe. When she started school, she was one of the first black students in a previously all-white primary school. She went on to get a law degree in Zimbabwe, and then she just kind of exploded in awesomeness for me. I love international travel, wow. So she went to Cambridge University to get a degree in international law, and also Graz University in Austria to pursue a doctorate in international law. Yeah. From there, she worked with an organization in Geneva, Switzerland, for legal aid on international trade law to developing countries. So cool. Yeah. After all of that, she decided to start writing professionally. Oh, I just feel like she's going to have such a body of experiences to pull from here. So I'm super excited to get into her work. She does already have a published short story collection. This is the title story for that collection. So it's also an Elegy for Easterly, and a novel, The Book of Memory, which is about a woman with albinism in a high security prison, and she's trying to remember what happened and write those experiences down. So it sounds really cool. But now, as we speak, in 2017 anyway, she started a DAAD fellow and writer in residence experience in Berlin, Germany. So yeah, her second short story collection, Rotten Row, came out in 2016 in the UK and South Africa, but that has just been bought by Scribner here in the US. And her second novel, Out of Darkness, Shining Light, what a title, right? Out of Darkness, Shining Light, is coming out later this year. So really looking forward to that. I've already read the first 12 pages of this one, and I'm hooked. I am totally hooked. So the premise of this story is the capital city of Zimbabwe, the Queen of England is coming for a visit, and they want to clean it up. They want to clean it up for the Queen. Unfortunately, they don't mean the trash. They want to clean up the poverty, the people. So several waves of people are removed from Zimbabwe and taken to this Easterly farm to live. They're told they're gonna have nice homes and plumbing, but here it is years later and they're still living in homes made of salvaged material and plastic sheeting. Yeah. I read the first two pages and I was utterly heartbroken, just heartbroken for the abject poverty that these people are in and the abject poverty of our main character. So that is Martha Mupengo, and she has a profound mental illness. We don't know yet what happened with her in her life, but it is heartbreaking in two pages. Now then by the fifth page, she lightens the mood a little bit and you just are immersed in the colorful characters in the community and this small town, small community gossip vibe, and it was just delightful for me. I am 12 pages in and can't wait to finish this video so that I can finish the book. I am just hoping that she can stick the landing for me, because the opening just blew me away. Exactly my kind of book. A different cultural experience from my own, a little bit of social consciousness. It was just perfect for me. Now I'm curious to hear what Shawn thinks about it. So take it away, Shawn.
Hey, Doris. Well, thanks for all that information about Petina Gappah. I didn't know anything. In fact, when I first started talking about this one volume short story, I said she was South African, so I have a lot to learn. That was fascinating. I'm really enjoying this story too, and it's ringing all sorts of bells in terms of connecting me to other reading I've done, especially this, which is my favorite novel from Africa ever, We Need New Names by No Violet Bulawayo. This was 2013, and I believe this short story was originally published 2009. And this is also a Zimbabwean novel. Well, the first half's in Zimbabwe, the second half's in America. But just briefly, the children on the loose wandering through the devastated urban areas is a big part of this novel and really beautifully, heartbreakingly depicted. And of course, it is here too. So lots of resonance here. Also, the forced removals. There's a forced removal in this one, and also in a South African novel that I just finished reading the other day, Mother to Mother by Sindiwe Magona, for Karen of Run Right Reads Book Club. And that has some heartrending depictions of the actual forced removal that I will not soon forget. I am fascinated by Martha, who's been given the name. It's not her name. Her mental illness, and the references to ancient Zimbabwean history. I didn't realize that's how that doofus Mugabe chose the new name for his country, from the Kingdom of Zimbabwe in the 12th century. And then the joke the man tells about the ruins of Zimbabwe was just one place. Gorgeous, here's a picture. And after Mugabe, it's the whole country is in ruins. I just can't wait to see where this goes. I'm going to be watching the child's play, the games the children play, because that also set off sparks, taking me back to Zora Neale Hurston's John Rose Gordvine and this master-slave hide-the-whip game they played. And there's nothing quite that dark so far about the games they're playing, but there's also a lot of children's games that turn quite dark in this. So there's a lot to watch out for, and I am completely engrossed. Over to you.
Well, thanks for those recommendations, Sean. I think I'm going to have to add a couple of books to my TBR. I'm really super interested in the We Need New Names. I can't believe you have another recommendation from Zimbabwe. That is just perfect. And I'm going to have to get another one of her books. I think I'll probably get one of the new releases, either the short story collection or her new novel, or both, because this was really awesome for me. I absolutely loved it. The ending, I didn't see that coming. Like, I loved the way Martha's story and Josephat's wife were starting to parallel. I could see that. But I guess I was just so immersed in the story that she was telling that I got lost in it and didn't, like, look to the future. But yeah. That was excellent. It left me thinking, that's for sure. I was just like, whoa, thinking about so many things. I don't want to spoil it because it's such a short little book, but excellent, excellent for me. What did you think? Oh, I'm so pleased. I'm 2 for 2 with these. So on to the next one. Thank you so much for turning me on to these books. Which one are we going to do next?
Hey, Doris. Well, I'm so glad that you loved it. I didn't quite love it, but I really liked it. So this was a 4-star read for me. And I guess what was missing, really, just comparing it to the Kazuo Ishiguro story, was that I didn't find myself shocked in a really pleasing way. But the story held my interest. I found the comparison between Martha and Mrs. Josephat to be a little bit too pat, perhaps. But no, I really enjoyed it. There was just so much in it to tease out. And like you, I really want to read more by Petina Gappah. So buddy read, perhaps? It also made me think about motherhood in a way that evoked Lenny Zumas's Red Clocks. So yeah, there's a lot of resonance with other recent reading. But no, this was quite a successful story. On to the next one.